Grab your Bible, turn over to 1 Corinthians again. I'm sorry. 2 Corinthians. I'll get it out here. Chapter 5. I want to take a few moments this morning. How many of you agree with a few moments? See, you got another right place to say amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I want to just kind of rehearse our glory conference that we had recently. If you weren't here, we had a great time. It's on our YouTube channel, right, CJ? The Believer's Church of Madera.
Yeah.
The Believer's Church of Madera on YouTube. Get on our channel and you can watch the services and hear the ministry that came forth over those five services. But as we had those services and after it was over, the Lord began to just quicken my heart about them and about how that He was, in each service, He was establishing a message for us to go forward in our lives as a church and as an individual, that it was like He was, I kind of shun from using the word formula or steps because sometimes that gets misunderstood. But how many of you know God's not disorganized? Sometimes it looks like to us He is.
Yeah.
Sometimes the organization of the Holy Ghost looks like chaos to us.
Yeah.
Amen. We can talk about that in the Bible. But He is a God of order, and He's always in our life every day in one way or another trying to get over to us what He needs to get over to us. And He has many different ways of doing that.
Oh, yeah.
He does it in that personal relationship, inward witness of the Holy Spirit. He does it in dreaming visions. He does it through preaching and teaching. I had a prophetic dream, probably 25 years ago. The Lord gave me the first real prophetic dream that I had. And in that dream, the Lord was warning me and asking me to warn the body of Christ about the future, because He showed me in this dream, without telling all about it, He showed me that how evil was going to be so finely tuned and darkness was going to be so deceptive.
Yeah.
In the days ahead, that if you weren't purposely,
yes,
purposely,
yes,
listening,
yes,
to,
yes,
the prophetic voice of God in the earth, that you would get caught up in that deception.
Yes.
And the Bible, witnesses to that. It talks about that there'll be a day when strong words are strong delusion.
Yeah.
And those words were used in that dream. And when I woke up 4 a.m, it felt like I'd never even been asleep. And the words strong delusion were like this. They were just flashing in my mind. I got up and looked at them, and what they mean in the original Greek in the Bible is you come to a place in your life where you no longer have the capability of choosing between right and wrong, good and evil. You are so, the lie has such a place in you, the darkness, that it makes the decision for you. And the scriptures talk about there will be a day when that happens in this earth. So it's not, we're scared of the boogeyman, we're scared of the devil, or it's not that, but we also need to make sure, we're told in the scriptures, walk in the light.
Right.
And you'll not live in the darkness.
Right.
And to walk in the light, you have to intentionally walk in the light.
Yes.
Right. You say, what is the light? The light is God's word. And His Spirit in you, revealing light to you.
Yes.
Jesus is the light of the world. He went on to tell His disciples, you're the light of the world.
Yes.
Amen. And so yes, we have to be those who want to walk in the light.
Yeah.
Now, the problem with that is when you say, I want light, and it shines on you, sometimes darkness is exposed.
Exactly.
A lot of Christians, unfortunately, I've seen over the years, and I was one of them myself for many years, so I'm not picking on them. My attitude is prayer and to help people. But a lot of Christians, they will walk with God until they get to what I call their pain point.
Yeah.
I'm all for Christianity as long as there's no cross in it.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Jesus said, no, you're going to have to carry your cross.
Yeah.
Now, what does He mean by that? Some people have translated that into, God gave me cancer as a cross. No, you don't have to suffer the things He suffered for you.
Amen.
But He didn't suffer persecution. He said that you're going to be persecuted. Jesus was perfect and He was persecuted. But He says, I've overcome the world for you, so you don't have to worry about not overcoming it either.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Praise God. But the cross that we have to bear many times is the fact that you have your will and God's will. Now, I know all of you in here are so holy that your will is just always in line with God's will. That was a joke. We all know that's a joke, right? But there are times when your will and God's will are going to be like this. The cross.
Yeah.
That's what Jesus, he got, when Adam and Eve crossed God's will in the Garden of Eden, and people began to do that throughout the ages, he got up on that cross, and he died for us because of that. So he set us free to be born again. By his grace and mercy, come back in. My blood has paid the price for you.
Yeah.
Spirit, soul, and body, socially, financially, every other way. Past, present, and future. But you still have a free will. Which means even though you're a born again, Bible toting, devil stomping, tongue talking Christian, you can still do your own thing. You can still choose for your will to go the wrong direction.
Right.
Amen? Amen. And so he wants us to understand that we have to make a decision that we are going to, even if it's as painful as enduring, and it is sometimes, because it's a death to the way, to the person you think you are, and the devil wants you to believe you are.
Right. Amen.
You will have to go through a death process sometimes.
Yeah.
And it's not easy. And it's not fun. And it doesn't feel good. But I'll tell you what, not everything that feels good is God. And not everything that feels bad is not God. Well, I can see we're getting excited about that. But I'll tell you this, just like Jesus going to the cross and doing what he did, what it produces after is a greater glory and freedom than you've ever walked in your life.
Thank
you, Lord. It's like Karen was saying earlier, go by what you know, not what you think. Amen?
Yes.
So I don't, what are you talking about? Get in the Word. Ask God to show you. It, listen, this is eternally true. This will be true after you're dead and gone.
It's true.
It was true before you got here, and it'll be true after you're gone.
Amen.
We live in truth. Jesus said, you know, that we're to walk in the truth. He said, if you'll become a disciple, he told some people who were, they thought they were cool because they were of the Abrahamic lineage, naturally. They thought they had it made. We're Abraham's seed. And he just told them, God could raise up seed from that rock right there if he needs to.
Yeah.
God's not impressed by your nationality. He loves your nationality. He made all the different people groups. He's a rainbow God. He loves different colors and different things and variety. Aren't you glad we aren't all just some robot all painted the same paint job? Amen. But that's not what it's about. What it's about is that you are a disciple in him. Jesus said if you become a disciple, you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free.
Amen.
If you continue in his word, he says,
yes.
You'll then know, and that word know means to become one with. It won't be just something you know about, something you've heard about. It'll start working in you. You'll begin to become one with truth. It'll actually be something you are instead of something you know.
Yes.
Gloria.
And that truth will then begin to set you free from who the devil's told you are or you think you are.
Amen.
I went through a process. Man, Lord, help me get to my message, please. I went through a process in around 2000 where I've talked about it before. It was the most painful situation I've ever been through. It was very painful physically, but that was a short-term thing. But the emotional pain, because I went into what they call post-traumatic syndrome, where I went back and forth from anxiety and depression. And I had good, well-meaning people tell me, why don't you just snap out of it?
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, everybody.
Come on.
I didn't want to snap into it.
Come on.
I just tried to snap into it. It doesn't make any sense to me.
Right.
I don't understand this. It's frustrating. It was the worst pain. I mean, I've had some physical pain in my life. I had a boulder pinned me to the ground when I was 11 years old. I've had different things happen in life. Most of them self-induced, but but this emotional pain was the worst thing I'd ever gone through in my life.
Yeah.
But when I got right down to the bottom and was ready to really get up on the cross, whatever it took, sometimes, you know, God will just let us squirm until we're ready to actually let him do what he needs to do. He's not going to violate your free will. And when I finally got serious with God, and I was willing to do anything,
amen.
He said, what this is really all about is the spirit of fear that was put into you, sown into your heart when you were a child, as you grew up, and the enemy now, you're at the harvest time of your life, and just like the parable of the wheat and the tares, they grow up together, and they come into harvest time together, and only in harvest time can you see what's genuine wheat and what is not real wheat. Because see, during harvest time, genuine wheat, when it's mature, when the wind blows, it moves with the wind. The God part of you flows with the wind of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
But the other stuff, I've heard it called darnel, I think is what they call it. It's stiff, it's hard, it won't move, and it's not good either. And just like the parable of the wheat and the tares, the Lord sent his angels to rip out in harvest time the things that are not of God, so that what is of God. And the Lord began to show me the difference between me and me under the influence of the spirit of fear. And I was amazed at how much fear I walked in. And it wasn't fun. Now, and if I hadn't understood the righteousness of God, and I'm accepted of God, and he loves me no matter what,
yes,
I would have went into a major condemnation trip.
Yes.
Guilt. Beating myself up. Shame.
Sure.
I'm a pastor for 30 plus years, and I'm dealing with this. I've been this way. What's wrong with me? I don't deserve to be in the ministry. You hear people say
yeah,
those times?
Yeah, yeah. Preach it.
Hey, nobody deserves to be in anything. He made us worthy. He qualified us.
Come on.
We can't be disqualified from something we never qualified for. Yes. He qualified us. Amen. And, but I had to go through this painful, at times painful process of confronting that in my life, acknowledging it was true, and then asking the Lord, and he helped me and showed me how to deal with it.
Yes.
Praise
yes,
God.
Amen.
So it's not all rosies and posies.
Right.
It's not all flowing on flowery beds of ease, as Brother Hagin used to say.
True.
There are those times when you have to make a decision that you're going to walk in the light, even if it kills you.
Yeah, that's right.
I remember one of the things, because one of my areas of my weaknesses in growing up and even in the past was provision. For whatever reason, the devil, God was able to plant in me a fear of not having provision in the future.
Right.
Of not having enough, not having, you know. I remember the devil would attack me when I was younger in ministry. You better quit this preaching stuff and go out and get in business again and make some money, because you're getting older and you're going to need some money when you get older. I know the devil's never told you a lie like that, but he told me.
Right.
And, you know, and so forth. Those kinds of things. And the Lord began to, you know, to deal with me about these things and show me how my thinking, even though, you know, I didn't want to admit, sometimes we're so good at not being honest with ourselves.
Because
we look at Jesus and we see him perfect and we get upset if we're not exactly like him.
Yeah.
Well, you're not going to be exactly like him. He's the Word made flesh. You're the flesh being made the Word.
Right.
You're growing in grace and knowledge of the Lord. You're being made into his image.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
It's a process.
Yes.
Don't worry about it.
Amen.
You're a building project. He's going to get you there.
Amen.
The Bible says, he which begot a good thing in you will do it. He'll accomplish it.
Yes.
Under the day of the Lord.
Yes.
And so, you know, I that whole thing of you know, the fear of the future, he began to address that in my life. And, you know, the devil understood where I was at. He was trying to save his harvest. He was trying to get his harvest of death in my life.
Yeah.
And so he's hammering me every day in my thought life and in my emotions.
Yep.
And one of the things was, you know, what if the church failed? What if you lose your house? What if the economy this? And what if that? And what if this? Now, you know, people are saying, well, Pastor Purcell, you deal with that? Absolutely. We're all just as human as any of you. I'm just somebody that has giftings in me to give to the body of Christ. I'm just like you. I got to face every demon in hell that comes down the pike.
Amen.
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 And I remember one day, finally, I just got tired. You got to get tired of the devil.
Yes. Yes.
And I told the devil, listen, I meant it. I didn't say it trying to, you know, deflect something again. I said, devil, let me tell you something.
Come on.
If I have to live in a tent and cook over a campfire,
yeah,
and follow God fully, that's what I will do.
Amen.
Last time I checked, there's a few more houses around than mine.
Amen.
And the Bible says he'll give me houses that I didn't build, land, you know, vineyards I didn't make. God's, my father owns a cattle on a thousand, he owns a planet.
Yes.
Right.
Now that may sound foolish to you. Maybe that's not your area where the enemy has been able to weasel in. But wherever it's at, you're going to have to confront it sooner or later.
Yes.
And let me tell you, this is the way it works. You've got to get totally honest with you about you.
Amen.
No games.
Yeah.
Lord, this is where I'm at. This is what I feel. Sometimes you have to even be honest about what, well, not sometimes, always. This is what I really believe.
Yeah.
Right. So
Men.
Because see, your faith, your belief level can be at different levels.
Right.
You know, depending on your past experience, usually. Usually people that are don't have a lot of trouble, you know, maybe their family doesn't have a lot of financial trouble growing up. They just automatically, hey, provision's there. You know,
right.
We're going to make it. Everything's fine. They just kind of are in an environment where their faith is strong in that area. Somebody else who doesn't have that experience, they're going to struggle sometimes, even when provision's there, or when even if it looks like provision's not going to be there.
Right?
Yeah.
Amen.
But we all have to be willing to step into that place.
Yes.
Amen.
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 Well, did you forget about the glory conference? I didn't either. Can I go into that a little bit, Lord?
Amen.
So whatever that meant to you this morning, it's not about other people. It's not about God. It's not his fault. None of it ever is. He's good all the time. He knows what he's doing. The problem is you. You don't look at him and find out what he's doing.
Mom.
You're too busy thinking what you want to do.
Right. Yeah.
I try to meet with him every day. Not because I want to be Hode.
Right.
Or, you know, oh, I'm earning my points in heaven. No, because I've got to hear from him.
Right.
To keep me on track.
Amen.
I've got to ask him questions. I've got to be honest with him and say, Lord, this looks to me like you're not doing your job here. What's going on?
Yes.
Yep.
I don't ask that in some kind of arrogance. This is what it looks to me like. I'm just being honest. Straighten me out here. Help me. And when we have that kind of relationship with the Lord, then we can move forward. But don't get upset if he says, like Nathan said to David when he denied what he did with Bathsheba and her husband for 9 months, you're the man. David had the authority, position, and power. He could have cut that prophet's head off instantly. But David wanted to be right.
Right.
He was a man after God's own heart.
Amen.
And he took it, went and fell on his face,
Amen.
Got it right with God, got up and moved on.
Amen.
And moved on in victory.
Amen.
If he would have cut that prophet's head off and sat there and cried, I guarantee you, David's life probably wouldn't have even been long on earth.
Yeah.
His kingdom sure would have come down.
Because
that would have been opening the door for the enemy to take him down.
Right.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Oh, is that worth the price of admission today?
Yeah.
Let me real quickly just try to buzz through these. Maybe we'll, you know, as time goes along, maybe we'll take them individually and talk about them. But these five speakers, the Lord began to show me that he was showing us something. Five steps, if you want to say it, or five revelations of truth. Brother Larry Huggins, of course, was with us on that Friday night. And 1 Corinthians, did I tell you 1 Corinthians? 2 Corinthians 5. Yeah, I'm in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. How many remember a little bit at least of what Brother Huggins preached that night? They're all available if you want to watch them. And I may use even some different scriptures than they use, but I just want you to get the nugget or the comprehension. This is the first step. He talked about, and let me just read verse 17 here. Therefore, if any person, any man or any person, be in Christ. Everybody say, I'm in Christ. You're in him. And he's in you. Jesus is, in John 17, his high priestly prayer right before he went to the cross, he was dancing and shouting and rejoicing about this fact right here. That we're not going to just be you over there and me over here. We're going to be in one another. We're going to be so close forever. You can't separate us.
That's
what it says in Romans 7, or Romans 8.
Right.
It lists a bunch of things that happen in life. spiritually and naturally, it says none of that can separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So he says here in verse 17, therefore if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, new species of being, a new spiritual species of being. Old things are passed away, behold, all things have become new. And Brother Huggins was talking about that one word in the Greek that it meant into, that we were put into or baptized into. The word baptized means immersed. There's different kinds of baptisms. One of them is baptized into the body. So the way God looks at you, he doesn't look at you like you look at you in the mirror, seeing your body, your outward tabernacle that your real spirit man is living in with your soul. He sees you in Jesus. When he looks at you, he sees Jesus. I'm going to let that soak in for just a minute. When the Father looks at you, he sees you in Christ. Now, he knows you're an individual. He knows that you're a body part, like we were talking about earlier, you're part of the corporate body. He knows that, you know, you're a personality that he created uniquely. He broke the mold after he made you. How many of you are glad?
It kind of trickles down.
Yeah, it does. It does. The acorn doesn't fall too far from the tree, does it? But anyway, he sees you totally identified in Jesus. Now, you've got to see yourself that way. Because if you don't, then the devil's opinion starts to count in your mind.
Come on.
Well, I told the Lord I loved him, and then later on I got in a fight with my mom, and I used some words I shouldn't have used. So you're defining, if you start thinking that's who you are, you are defining yourself outside of Christ. Now, I'm not saying that you can just sin and do whatever you want to do. The Bible says we're to be holy like he's holy. Holy simply means set apart to a purpose. You need to be sincere in your heart toward him.
Yeah.
If you may have prayed a sinner's prayer, but if you never prayed it by giving him your heart, sincerely giving him your heart, all you did was mouth words. That's why Paul says over in 1 Corinthians 12, no person can say Jesus is Lord, spiritually speaking, because he's dealing with spiritual gifts and all that. He says, no person can spiritually say Jesus is Lord, but in the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
In sincerity, in your heart.
Right.
Amen? Because when you get sincere in your heart, the Holy Ghost gets involved.
Yes.
And that's how you become that new creature. The Holy Spirit comes to live in you, and you are now a new creature in Christ. Whoa. So you need to establish the fact. Larry mentioned the book, In Him. I don't know how many copies we have, but it's a little mini book Kenneth Hagin wrote years ago. And I encourage you, whatever you have to do, to get a copy of that. Maybe we'll have we got a bunch of those or just a few? We just got a few of them, it looks like.
I probably have a few of them.
Yeah. Well, maybe we'll order a bunch of them and just put them out here and you can take one home. Because if you don't know who you are to start with, the rest of it's not going to make any sense.
Yeah.
You'll live your whole Christian life on this teeter-totter. You're you in the flesh, that's who you think you are, now you're you in Christ.
Right.
Now you're you in the flesh, you in Christ. You in the flesh, you in Christ.
Yes.
That is not your identity.
Come on!
Just because you're a human, you miss it. Like Romans 7 talks about Paul, how, you know, the things I don't want to do, I end up doing. And then just because you're a human and all these things happen, that does not change your identity.
Yes.
I am the son of Bill and Maxine Purcell, naturally speaking. And if I went out and committed mass murder or robbed a bank, that's not good, but that doesn't change anything about me being their son.
Right.
They may not want to admit I'm their son. But it doesn't change. You're in Christ. Amen. That has to be established. Secondly, Pastor Warren Marr preached on Saturday morning. He shared about his experience of watching things happen in his personal life and in his church, and how he went through this thing that to him, from a human perspective, looked like I failed.
Yes.
Ever been there?
Yes, sir.
Even though I've invested my life in ministry to do what God, and all of that, he went through it, and he had to go through a time of coming to a place where he understood, and we already kind of talked about it a little bit, that no matter mistakes I might have made, and oh, we've all made enough to fill a luxury liner. go across the ocean.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
God sees me as precious.
Lord
God. God loves me.
Thank you, Lord.
Over in Ephesians 1:6, I won't turn over there for the sake of time. The Bible says that you and I, now that we're in Christ, we are accepted in the beloved, in the beloved. Well, I know I'm supposed to love God, Pastor. Yeah, you are, but you're also supposed to be loved.
Yes.
You're also supposed to let Him love you.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
It says you're accepted. That word accepted, you look it up in the Greek, it's the same Greek word that was used in Luke chapter 1 when the angel Gabriel came to Mary and said, Hail, hi. And he said to her, You are highly favored. You, that's the same Greek word that says you're accepted. You know how God looks at you? He highly esteems you. He highly favors you. You got more favor on your life than you could ever use up in your lifetime. But see, if the devil can get you to see it different, and I fail, or somehow because the enemy's stirring the sandstorm up out here and making it look like you're going to fail or whatever, some kind of natural circumstance, and then you begin to depart from the fact that I'm in Christ, the devil has to get past Jesus to get to me.
Come on.
Amen.
Come on, are you here?
It's good.
Yes.
Amen? And that somehow I've messed up enough that, how many of you ever had the devil tell you, Sister So-and-so, he used to pull this one on me all the time when I was young. Well, Sister So-and-so, she's a prayer warrior at church, and she's been following the Lord for a long time, and she's a holy woman of God, and yeah, of course she got healed last week, but remember what you said the other day?
Yes.
I did disqualify you again. But you know what I messed up? You know, God knew you were going to blow it, even though you got saved many years ago. He still knew you were going to blow it. He knows the whole future.
Sure.
And He still took you. Yeah. Why? Because it's not about you.
Exactly.
I mean, it is in the sense that He loves you, but it's not about your human failures, your learning to grow, your moving forward, coming into things, and making mistakes. It's about that He loves you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And anything that you can mess up, He can fix up if you let
Him.
If you give Him. If you just start following that shepherd on a daily basis, listening for His voice, opening, like Karen said, opening His mouth, getting with Him. How are you going to follow somebody you don't have a relationship with? I mean, if my wife and I, we've been married now a long time. 46 years. I knew that was it. I would say 45. So. It's coming up though, right, Karen?
Yes.
Right. May 1st. I finally remember that part. But what would it be like if we just never talked to each other? Somebody out here probably thought, well, that'd be wonderful. No. That's not a relationship. Communication.
Amen.
Communication is the strength of a relationship.
That's right.
I'm going to say it again. Communication is the strength of a relationship.
Amen.
When I stopped listening to God, I got goofy.
Yep.
Goofier than I am right now.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
So, what Warren was, I think, bringing forth among other, and you may have got something totally different out of it. You know, the Lord meets us and sometimes says things to us about what that person's saying that other people don't get. But what I heard in that and what I believe the Lord showed me was that you're in Him, He's one with you, He has, He's one spirit with you, the Bible says, and that He cherishes you.
Yeah,
He's not standing back going, they blew it again. Can't you put out there and just kick them in the rear real hard one time?
Yeah.
No. But right on the other hand, He's saying, look, if this is going to work out for you, you're going to have to have a relationship with me.
Amen.
Meet with me every day. Let me talk to you.
Amen.
Go to church. Listen to the different voices of the Lord that come through the earth and through different people. Then thirdly, Brother Bob Lawman. Don't you love Brother Bob?
Oh, yeah.
That guy's a sharp dresser, isn't he?
Yeah.
He had some classy looking suits. I asked him the first time, I go, what, are you running for president now? I'm just kidding. He probably wanted to say to me, why don't you dress up a little bit? But he and his wife are precious people. He talked about the open door. He talked about the open door. See, when you accept that you're one with Jesus, and that he's in you and you're in him, you're never separated, and you allow him to love you. You know, I got saved when I was a kid because they were preaching hellfire and damnation. Now, that's the truth.
Yep.
There is a hell to shun and a heaven to gain.
Yeah.
Hell is a real place.
Yeah, yes, there is.
I know a lot of people don't want to believe that. Some cults teach it's not, but Jesus believed in it.
That's right. Yeah.
Because when he taught parables, he said it's like unto, it's as if. But when he talked about hell, he said there was a certain rich man.
That's right.
And he talked about it going to hell, and he talked about the separation of Abraham's bosom and hell and so forth and so on. Hell is real. And the Bible even says, some people save with fear. Maybe I was one of those hard heads that had to be saved with fear. I don't know.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Some people save with fear, jerking their very feet out of the fire.
Yes.
Todd Bentley had a relative that was off into some deep sin and hated Christians, hated Christianity. The guy's laying there dying. He's in his deathbed. They're trying to lead him to the Lord. He's cussing them out and telling them he doesn't believe, blah, 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 blah. So they just kept praying for him. And one night, they got a phone call in the middle of the night, and it was him wanting them to come quickly to the hospital. They got down there, and he told them, you keep preaching what you're preaching, man. Keep preaching what you're preaching. He said, I went to hell. I saw it. It's real.
Amen.
And he got saved.
Amen.
Some people have to get saved instead of the message of heaven, the message of hell.
That's right.
And it's, you know, it's not God's best. He wants people to know him, that he loves them. And see, and that, I didn't have much of a relationship with the Lord after I got saved, because it's hard to have a relationship with somebody you're afraid of.
Right.
And that's how I saw God. Not a godly fear and honor and respect and so forth, but I was just scared of him, man. He might drop me in hell. And that damaged my relationship. You know, I didn't really have one for many years because of that.
Amen.
Until finally I read in the Bible one day and heard somebody preach, God is love.
Exactly.
And the reason he warns us, you know, as a parent, you warn your children, don't go playing a road, you're going to get killed.
Right.
It's true.
And you put a little fear of God in it if you have to get that. Why? Because it's better that man will like you now, live a long life, and love you later, than like you not, you know, than have it their way now and get killed.
Yeah, exactly.
Praise God. But Brother Long was preaching about open door. The open door. So when you accept who you are in him, who he is in you, you begin to understand that he's precious. He loves it when you wake up in the morning. He loves to spend the day with you. One prophet recently was having a visitation of the Lord, and he said, the Lord told him, says, you can ask me whatever you want to. And so he started asking him about God, about Jesus' opinion on things. One thing he asked him, he says, what do you think about sports? He said, well, I'm not against sports as long as you don't do it without me.
Yeah.
That's good.
Exactly.
He likes what you like.
Yes, he does.
As long as it's not going to hurt you. He's against sin, because sin, the wages of sin are death. He doesn't want to see you die. He doesn't want to see you live tormented by demons in your mind. He doesn't want to see you live in bondage. He tells you not to do things because he loves you.
Amen.
And so this open door, once you get to those first two places in your heart, now there's an open door of fellowship and relationship that's open before you, before God. Hebrews 4:14-16 talks about, come boldly into the throne of grace.
Exactly.
The throne of favor.
Yes.
But see, if you don't think you're favored, you're going to be like I was when I got saved as a kid. Oh, God. Let's go hide from God. But if you know who he is and who you are in him and how he feels about him, then you can go through the open door of fellowship.
Amen.
John, when you know he had the revelation, the book of Revelation was revealed to him, and his experience there. It said at one point after the Lord instructed him about the churches on the earth, it says he looked and he saw an open door in heaven.
Yeah.
Well, that door is open, folks.
Yes.
Absolutely.
That door is open. It's a spiritual door.
Yes, it is.
When we think of open doors, we think of, oh, I'm going to get hired by this company and go through this door of employment. Well, there's a truth to that. But the door I believe the Lord's talking about right here is a door of fellowship, relationship, a door of learning, a door of revelation.
Yes. I love it.
I don't care how much you, me, or anybody else on this earth understands about the things of God, there's another place.
Yes.
That you have to go through a door to get to.
Amen.
And when you get that understanding, that wisdom, the Lord has been, lately I've saw a lot of prophetic things about wisdom. The Lord's been talking to me about asking for wisdom, praying for wisdom,
yes.
So that we can access, see, we've got to access right now in revelatory understanding what He wants us to see and know, not only about now, but about the future, so that we can cooperate with Him and go forward. So go through the open door. You know, we come in here and worship. He's standing there with the door open.
Yes.
And worship is not singing a song. Worship is not closing your eyes and lifting your hands. Those are things you do sometimes when you worship.
Yes.
Jesus said to the Samaritan woman who was a little confused on worship and where you were, you know, she was all caught up in where you worship. Because when the Jews came back from Babylon and they began to intermingle with the tribes that were there, I think it was Ezra, if I remember correctly, came and he told them, you can't do this if you're going to be a priest. The law forbids it. So you're either going to have to break off this covenant you have with this woman that's not a part of the tribe of Israel, or you're not going to be able to be a priest anymore. And some of them chose to take their wives and kids and go and leave. And they went to this mountain and they built a temple on this mountain, like a substitute temple, I guess. They built this temple and they began to try to pursue God from that place.
Yeah.
And so Jesus, at Jacob's well, he's talking to this woman who that was her thinking about things. And he told her, he said, if you're going to worship God, you've got to worship Him in spirit and truth.
Yeah.
You've got to go through the door. I don't ever, I mean, in my mind, I'm like anybody else. I'm hearing what's going on in this building. I'm, you know, maybe my thoughts are going to this, that, or the other. But in my heart, I see myself, I use my sanctified imagination.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Everything God's given you is good.
Yeah.
And your imagination is to be used.
Yeah.
You use it all the time. That's why you're so full of worry and fear.
Oh, yeah.
What if this happens? I hope that works out. You're imagining. They did statistics years ago. I don't know how it is now, but years ago they said that less than 10% of what we worry about ever comes to pass. But how many people spend 90% of their day caught up in worry? Tormented by demonic thoughts. We have to not let the devil use our imagination. I like to read Hebrews chapter 12 and see myself, because it's true spiritually. You are come unto Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, and so forth. It talks about, it describes what's all there for us. So I see myself. Yeah, my body's in this building. My mind is aware of things here. But in my spirit, I see the throne. I see God. I go there in my spirit. I worship Him in spirit and in truth.
Yes.
Whatever the truth is, that's what I want.
Yes.
And when you learn to do that, when you go through that spiritual door, that's where great things start happening.
Yep.
That's where you begin to be heavenly minded.
Amen.
The old saying of being too heavenly minded to be earthly good is wrong. You won't be any earthly good unless you're heavenly minded, or very little anyway.
Amen.
Unless you see it from God's perspective. Hallelujah.
Right.
Is this helping you today?
Amen.
It sure helped me when the Lord showed it to me. And then our fourth speaker that weekend was Tony.
Yes.
Tony and Mary Kruger, Pastor and Mrs. Kruger from back in Missouri. Now, I got up that morning early and went in and sat in my chair like I always do and just opened my heart to the Lord and began to worship Him. And I'm just listening, because many times that's when He'll either give me a scripture or He'll tell me I need to repent for what I said yesterday or whatever. Got to get it all squared away, right? And that morning, immediately, Malachi 3:10. Now, every Christian that's ever been in church for very long and have been where they take up offerings knows that scripture. Matter of fact, a lot of people are sick of that scripture. Although they shouldn't be. And, and of course it's about tithes and offerings. Bring all the tithe and offering into the storehouse that there may be meat on my table. Well, that morning, Tony and Mary got up and they started talking about that. they started talking about tithes and offerings.
They did.
And I'm always, when somebody does that in this church, I'm not afraid to talk about it. I mean, I'll preach it if God wants me to, and leads me to do it, of course. But I'm always glad that somebody other than me teaches it.
Right.
Because it takes the, you know, motive of me trying to get you to put something in the offering out.
Right.
Amen? And so I was sitting over there saying, hallelujah, yeah, good, that's good, God.
Right.
That's good stuff, and it was good stuff. But turn with me over to Hebrews chapter, let's see here, chapter 7. Tithe and offering. Really what they were teaching about wasn't just tithe and offering. Tithe and offering is a vehicle of honor. Everybody say honor.
Honor.
Honor is big in the scriptures. Get your concordance out or your cell phone or whatever you use to reference it. Look up the word honor and just follow it through the Bible. You will be amazed. You see, God is a king.
He is.
And he operates under the king system, the theocracy system.
Right.
There's one vote that's his. But you don't dishonor a king and have it work out for you. And it's not because God's on this big ego trip, because when I honor God for who he is, I'm connecting with God and all that he is.
Amen.
Are you here?
Yes.
And you know, the scriptures talk about your gift will make room for you and bring you before great men. I used to read that scripture and think, well, whatever spiritual gifts are in me, you know, God will give me favor, and I'll maybe, you know, maybe a politician or some person that's, you know, well, that's true too. God will use that to bring you into those places. But your gift is what you bring to offer to the king.
Exactly.
They understood in their culture, you don't walk into the palace, you don't walk into the presence of the king coming in there with your shirt tail hanging out and your hand in one pocket. Hey, Kingy, what's up, dude? You came in there with honor.
Amen.
Amen.
You came in because what you're doing is you're saying, you are who you are, and I'm connecting with you by honoring you.
Amen.
See, whatever you put out is what comes back to you, the Bible says.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
And so Jesus now, and we don't have time to, you know, build this up or get into it and explain it much. Jesus now, it says here in Hebrews, excuse me, Hebrews chapter 7, look at verse, let's look at verse 8. Actually, you know what, let's look at verse 1. This Melchizedek was a king and priest that lived back in Abraham's day. Abraham's nephew got taken captive by some warring nations. And Abraham took his train service, went down, you know the story, went down, defeated these people, took all of the spoils from all the other places that had been spoiled and people that had been taken, and brought it back. And when he came to Jerusalem, when he came to Salem, which is Jerusalem, king of Salem, it says here, Melchizedek, king of Salem, this king came out to meet him, bringing bread and wine. And it says here, let's just read it, for Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest, notice he's a priest of Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. This king, or this priest, blessed Abraham, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all.
Yeah.
That sound familiar?
Yep.
Being, by interpretation, king of righteousness, and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace. So this man, who was a type and shadow of Jesus in his present kingly and priestly ministry, was a type and shadow who was a king and a priest.
Yeah.
And by the way, it says in Revelation that you and I have been made kings and priests unto our God. There again, it's that being in Jesus, inheriting who he is and being part of what he is. Without father, without mother, without descent, having neither. See, he's proving to them he wasn't of the lineage of Aaron. He wasn't of the lineage of the priesthood that was operating in Israel before the cross. Without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abideth a priest continually. Now verse 4. Now consider how great, everybody say great.
Great.
That word in the Greek means of much size or dignity. Consider how great this man was unto whom even the patriarch, Abraham, gave a tenth of the spoils. He tithed
yes.
to this king and priest.
Yes.
Why? Consider how great. His dignity, his position, who he was. See, tenth, ten fingers. Tenth, the tithe, is when you come with the tithe, you're saying, God, I'm holding nothing back. I'm giving you from my heart. I'm not holding a knife behind my back as I approach you. I'm not holding back from you. I'm not trying to play both sides of the fence.
Yeah.
I am giving wholeheartedly. Jesus talked about it. He said in Matthew 6, he said, where your treasure is where your heart is.
Yes. Yeah.
People go around and write these goofy books, you know, you don't have to tithe today and all this stuff. They don't read that. They need to read the book of Hebrews.
Yeah.
And it's not about paying the bills of the church. It's not about, I heard one guy, he said it was a tax under the Old Testament. No, it wasn't. It was worship.
Yes.
It was honor.
Yes.
It was spiritual connection.
Yes.
Now I can tell you, I'm just going to be blunt about it. Over the last 30 plus years, I have watched people who didn't tithe, and I've watched their life come apart eventually. Was it because God's ticked off? I'm just going to let your life come. No, it was because what Jesus taught in Matthew 6, it says that if you're bound up by the spirit that's behind wealth that the enemy operates in, what's the term there? Mammon, the spirit of Mammon. He said you cannot serve Mammon and serve God at the same time.
Right.
Well, if I'm serving God, God not only protects me, takes care of me, provides for me, I'm able to see. And he says over there in Matthew 6, he says that if you have a heart that is
stingy
is what the word means. Yeah, I'm trying to think of the word that's over there.
Evil.
Yeah. See, we all preach this at the same time. If you have an evil heart, and that word evil, you go to any Jew that understands the scripture, he'll tell you that means stingy. You have that kind of a heart, it says the light that's in you is darkness.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wow. And he says if the light's in you darkness, how great is the darkness?
Wow.
So tithing offering is not about just, oh, I got to give. Oh, no. Jesus as king and priest. And I didn't quite get there, but look what it says here. Verse 8, let's jump down there. Here, on earth, men that die receive the tithe. We receive the tithe, don't we? There, in heaven, he receiveth them of whom it is witness that he liveth. And he's talking about Jesus. If you want to read back to verse 20 of chapter 6 there, it says, whether the forerunner is for us entered in, even Jesus made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. So what he's saying is this, is that Jesus is our king and priest. He's our high priest in this instant, and just as the people would under the law bring the tithe to the high priest, that was part of them being in a position for God to be able to bless them and God to be able to lead them and help them walk in the fullness of light and understanding. And it wasn't just about provision, it was about being able to see spiritually.
Exactly.
I can talk to somebody usually for about 5 minutes, ask them certain questions, and I can tell you whether they're tithing or not.
Amen.
And it's not questions about money, you're tithing.
Right.
Because there's certain things people just cannot see.
Yeah.
They can't see it. Why? Because what Jesus said in Matthew 6. So, honor for God. And, you know, they're in the priesthood because of the, and I'm talking about myself, but the position of that under-shepherd and that priestly type thing that we walk in to minister to you, that can only happen if you honor him through the tithe and offering.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. It is covenant.
Now don't give under compulsion. The Bible tells us not to do that.
Right.
If you don't believe this, and you're going to do it because you're under compulsion, God's making you, you better keep your money, you're going to need it.
Amen. Right. Yeah.
Because you're demonically aligned, and the devil will take everything from you. Yeah. And he has the right to.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you believe that guy when he preached Sunday morning? He told me if I didn't tithe, my life's going to fall apart.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Right.
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 True.
Yeah. True.
Amen.
Amen.
I wish I could tell you, go give it somewhere else so that you don't, you know. But you better give where God tells you.
Amen.
And if this is your local church, you need to put some stuff in the storehouse, as the Bible says.
Right.
Now there's other giving. There's tithes. There's offerings, which is a free will thing you do.
Yep.
because you love the Lord, and you just, I like to listen to the Holy Ghost where offerings are concerned. Lord, how much you want me to give this guest speaker? How much you want me to? And then there's almsgiving, which is giving to the poor, giving to people that are struggling.
Sure.
We take that offering up once a month after our communion service, and we use it to help give food away and to do other things and so forth. And, you know, God wants to use you in that too.
Right.
But Terry, why am I calling him Terry? Tony and Mary Kruger, that next step, see, look at it. I'm in Christ, I need to identify with Him, I'm precious to Him, I'm not going to let the devil, you know, steal my relationship somehow, and so I'm going to walk with Him, I'm going to talk with Him, I'm going to pursue Him through the open door of fellowship, and what He's going to do is He's going to start having you be a blessing.
Yes! Amen!
You got to give it all.
Yes.
The Lord told me, I was driving down Yosemite Avenue years ago, and He was dealing with me about certain things that I was holding back on out of fear. And He said, don't fool yourself, John. Whatever part of you I don't own, the devil does. Whatever part of you I don't dominate and rule over, the enemy will. And He told me this. He said, you're not smart enough to outfox the devil.
Amen.
He's had thousands and thousands of years of manipulating human beings with fear and deception, and you are no match for Him without me. So you need to yield to me and give everything in you and that you have to me and live that way. Otherwise, He's got access.
Yes.
And I've watched Him at times do that. Number five. We're almost done. Oh my gosh, it's almost done. The last level. The wild man from Wisconsin. What did he preach on? Anybody remember? New level. Higher level. So when you know who you are in Christ, you live that way, you identify with that. You walk in that place of not letting the enemy tell you that you're not precious, to pull you away from God, and you walk in that. You pursue God through an open door of relationship. And then when you go through that open door before Jesus worshiping Him, you do what He tells you to do in honoring people, honoring Him,
yep,
doing what He tells you to do.
Yes.
Then you're in a position where God, there's no demonic darkness between you and Him. There's no violation,
right,
of relationship and kingdom.
Amen.
Now He can bring you into a level and a place that He has for you.
Amen.
And that place, I don't have time to talk about it, but that place is fullness.
Yes, yes, yes.
Lord.
That place is fullness.
Yes.
The fullness of who He has intended for you to be in Him on this earth and beyond.
Yes.
And it's different for everybody, but that's a place that God takes us to. Peter got there.
Yeah.
He started off a self-will, full of himself, type A, arrogant fisherman, know-it-all. Got a revelation from God and then tried to run Jesus' life with it right afterwards. Boasted and said, Lord, I'm not running. I'll stand with you. And he meant it because he grabbed the sword and took a swing at a guy. But then when it all came out the way he didn't think it was going to come out, he did what everybody else did. He ran, hid. Became depressed, became despondent, backslid, went back to his old job fishing. And the disciples followed him. Jesus had to come and restore him back to ministry, back to his place. But eventually, he got to a place where he had so much God on him and in him that if you got close to him, the devil left, that the devil was on you. The Lord told me one day as I was studying and praying, He said, Peter is one of the types and shadows. What's the word type and shadow he used? What do they call it when they make something, a model of something that they're wanting to be?
Prototype.
He's a prototype of the glorious church.
Yes.
Because when you study those words there around what happened, he would had an overshadowing and covering of God on his life because he was promoted into it.
Glory.
Like yes. Mary was promoted into
yes.
being the mother of Jesus Christ. He was promoted into this place and was overshadowed by the Holy Ghost. And then the next word said there was a luminous cloud of glory that came out from him. It wasn't his shadow that healed people. It was the overshadowing of the glory that flowed out of him.
Yeah.
the glorious church is going to be full of glory.
Yes.
If you want to see what the glorious church looks like, look at Jesus.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's what I got out of the glory conference. That's what the Lord showed me. It was after the fact. I enjoyed all the messages and all that was preached and all that was done. But God was showing me that He was showing us some steps that we can take.
Yes.
Into that greater glory, that greater place He has.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
And so I don't care this morning if you feel like you're not even to step one. Start.
Yeah.
Make a decision. If you'll climb the steps, God will meet you.
Yeah.
At every level. Yeah. Father, we thank You for Your word this morning. Thank You for the truth, for its truth that sets us free.
Yes, God. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, glory.
Yep.
I love living in the future.
Yes,
because I know I can see some things. And I know you can too. I'm not bragging on you. But I know some places we're going to.
Yeah.
Two prayer meetings ago on Tuesday, I thought I was in April already.
Yeah.
Didn't realize until a few days later I wasn't. It just happens sometimes. Thank you. And I'm telling you, exactly what the Bible says is true. The hell you've been through, the torment, the attacks of the enemy, your own mistakes and things that you've done to yourself and that kind of thing. That's all just like a mother that's having a child. All of that pain, all of that stuff that she went through to get that baby in this earth. It's going to be that way, folks, just up ahead of us.
Yep.
If we'll keep going through the birth canal of producing the glorious church and the fullness of God in our life. And God's given us instruction here. He's showing us the pathway.
Yes.
He's showing us how to go there.
Yes.
And so, Father, I pray in Jesus' name for every person under the sound of my voice that hears this either today or maybe even later, I pray in Jesus' name that they will be stirred in their hearts and that the zeal of the Lord will rise up in them, that the boldness of God will rise upon them, Father, and that they'll see that You are leading them, that if they just keep their focus on You, if they just keep following Your voice, if they keep believing the things that You say to them and move with those things, Father, that You so wonderfully revealed to us through the glory conference and through those that spoke, that we are coming into the fullness, and it's coming faster than people think it is. Lord, because of the season we're in and the time we're in, glory to God, hallelujah.
Yeah.
We thank You that You are turning things around and You are putting things on track.
Yes.
You're putting us back on the foundation. You're building the glorious temple. In Jesus' name.
Thank You, Holy Spirit.
We praise You for it this morning, Father. We praise You for it this morning. In Jesus' name. You know, I need to share this because it came to me earlier and I just kind of let it go and it came back to me again. There's somebody watching on the internet that you have left your church. I don't know if you left out of offense or whatever, but you know in your heart it's your church. And your life hasn't been working out, and it's not going to work out. I love you, but I'm telling you the truth. You need to get back where God put you.
Thank you.
Just submit yourself to the Lord. Go back where God put you. Submit to leadership. I'm not saying you do everything they say. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. Me or anybody else, if we get up and tell you to do something that's not scriptural, you don't have to follow that. Amen?
Amen.
But there's somebody that your life has been coming apart on you. You've been asking God why. You've been crying out to the Lord. And He's telling you, you need to go back where I put you. And connect. And when you do, you just watch what God does.
Amen.
Well, let's stand.
Thank you.
Good work.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Just take this home today and meditate on it. Look to the Lord. See what He has to say about it. Amen. I feel like I've done what I was supposed to do in sharing with you today. Praise You, Father. Lord, we just give You praise today. Father, I thank You for making us a family. That we are the family of God. We're blood relatives through Your blood. We praise You for that. And Lord, I thank You for the unity that You're bringing us into. I thank You, Father, that You're taking us down a path to create that thing that needs to be done so that You can fully inhabit the church. Fully inhabit us as the glorious church. We thank You for that, Lord. I pray for each person. I pray that this week as they fellowship with You, revelation comes to them. They see and understand things they haven't seen or understood before. I thank you, Father, for those that might need to let you confront certain things in their life and just be honest with you so you can heal them and help them. I thank you for that, Lord, that they don't run from the pain of their cross, but that they climb up on that cross and let you kill their flesh in that area so that the glory of God can come forth. We thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for loving us enough to tell us truth and to bring us into fullness. We praise you for it, and we bless your people this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a good afternoon tonight. Michael, you ministry.